on this great occasion, lovely for you to be here, we welcome you to local Allen's Club. Just a few little sort of hostess things. If you'd like to use the room during the service, could you please put your hand up and one of us will take you to the toilet. There are two toilets available, so if you do need them, please ask. And when the service is over, I think the clergy are going out one way, but we will have to follow one way system out through the tower, and then you can go and locate the other side of the still time. Okay, thank you. Enjoy the service.
Thank you. name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace and peace be with you.
And with you, Lord.
Please sit down. Very welcome to all of you to St. Cadoc's Trevithin for this very special service where we're licensing your new ministry area leader, Kate O'Sullivan. It's great to have Kate with us. Kate and I know each other from Manchester Diocese, and I can vouch for her. She's okay. In fact, she's better than okay, as you will discover. Good also to have Alicia as well, Kate's daughter, who's here with us as well as a supporter for Kate. Of course, in normal times, many other people would be here this evening, not just from across the ministry area, but perhaps even from Manchester, to come down and support Kate in this very important step that she's taking. But we all know that we are where we are, and we're doing the best we can given the restrictions that are in place. And I'm sure when the time comes and we're able to celebrate and party, there will be a proper celebration and a proper welcome where you can all get together and meet and celebrate Kate's arrival in the usual way. Before we proceed with the service, there are a few people that I would like to thank. First and foremost, I'd like to thank the church wardens, both here and across the ministry area, those of you that have been managing the church, not just during a vacancy, but during the pandemic as well. It's been an extraordinarily difficult and challenging time for all of us. And certainly in a vacancy, it's the church wardens that carry the burden of responsibility. So I want to take this opportunity of thanking the wardens and indeed all the officers of the churches across the ministry area for all that you've done to support the life of the church during these last 12, 13 months especially. I'd like to thank those who have helped to cover services during the vacancy. I am aware, once again, that the church wardens have taken a good share of that, leading here and elsewhere, but also to thank the clergy that have come as well from across the ministry area, but also the Archdeacon and others who've come to ensure that worship has continued, when that, of course, has been possible in person. And I know that we've all got used to Zooming and doing things online. And whatever you think about that, it has actually helped us to keep the life of the church going, to keep our worship going, to keep our social contact and our mutual support going. I'd like to thank somebody who isn't here, but who's played a significant part in Kate's vocation and nurturing, and that's the training in convents in Manchester, Father Ian Gomsall, who's been working alongside Kate certainly for the last year or so. And training in convents have a really important role in nurturing the vocation and ministries of those in their care. I don't know whether Ian's watching this evening, but I hope that if it's not this evening, he'll be watching at some point in the future. And I'd like to just record my thanks both to him and to the people of St. Chrysostom's up in Manchester for travelling alongside during this last part of the curacy, especially. So we return to our service sheets now, and after just a few minutes of quiet, as we gather our thoughts and remind ourselves that we meet together, whether here or elsewhere, we meet together in the presence of God. And so we pray. Father, has called us to follow Christ, a holy nation, to declare the wonderful deeds of him who has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Let us confess the times when we have failed to heed this call. Lord Jesus, you said to your disciples, "You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you." Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, we know that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you appointed us to go out and bear fruit that will last. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you and set you free from sin. Strengthen you in goodness and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. God our Father, Lord of all the world, through your Son you have called us into the fellowship of your universal church. Hear our prayer for your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry each may be an instrument of your love. And give to your servant Kate, now to Christ, the needful gift of grace. Through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen.
Listen to the Gospel of Christ according to St. John. I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have the power to lay it down. I have the power to take it up again. I receive this command from my Father. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Lord.
May I speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. One of the letters I received following the announcement that I was to become the Bishop of Monmouth was from an old school friend who'd spent a lot of time in Wales as part of his army training. "Ah, Wales," he wrote, "a land full of mountains, rain, and sheep." Well, I haven't had the chance to see that many sheep, given the lockdowns of the last year. But I know that certainly in St. David's Diocese, many vicars will have more sheep in their ministry area than people. Shepherding, of course, has changed considerably since Jesus' day. But the principle of caring, often to a sacrificial degree for the flock, remains. I remember some years ago, when the snows fell heavily on the mountains of Wales, hearing stories on the news of farmers taking considerable risks trying to rescue their sheep from snowdrifts on the hills to safety on lower ground. In our reading tonight, Jesus uses what would have been a very familiar image to the crowds gathered to listen to him, that of the Good Shepherd. Familiar not just because sheep and shepherds were all around them, part and parcel of the sights, sounds, and smells of daily life, but because it's an image used in one of the prophecies given to Ezekiel. The prophecy speaks against the religious leaders, the shepherds of Israel, for looking after themselves rather than caring for the sheep, for not tending the weak or healing the sick, not binding up the injured or bringing back the strayed or seeking the lost. Here in our passage today, Jesus describes himself in contrast to those shepherds, those religious leaders. I am the good shepherd, he tells them. I care for the sheep to the point of laying down my life for them. The model of the good shepherd is closely linked with that of the priest. At their ordination, called to the priesthood, are charged with modelling their life on that of the shepherd, caring for their flock, serving the needs of the community, and mindful of Ezekiel, putting others first before themselves. It's a powerful image that reminds all priests of the responsibilities they are taking on and the weight of the call to which they have responded. It's also a reminder of the privilege given to the ordained to be sharing in the work of Christ in such a profound way. But like all imagery, it has its limitations and can break down pushed too far. Far too many priests can feel obliged to sacrifice themselves to the point where their own health and well-being suffer, or their families suffer. Whilst this degree of self-sacrifice can be lauded and admired, I'm not sure that this is actually what God asks of those he calls. So please hold Kate to account on this and ensure she doesn't work herself into the ground. Equally problematic is what the model says to the laity of the church and the people of the community. If the priest is the shepherd, good or otherwise, then it leaves everyone else being sheep, passively following and bleating as they go. So whilst the shepherd model is good and helpful to a degree, it's important not to push it too far, not least because Jesus is the good shepherd for priests as well as everyone else. And we're now beginning to realize that priest as the shepherd of the flock has probably been a contributive factor in discouraging the flock, the people of God, from recognizing and exercising their own ministries and using their own gifts and skills, wisdom and experience to enrich the life of the church, even though that is the call of all who are baptized into Christ. So what is Kate's role to be as the ministry area leader here? Well, first, her task is to build up the church, to establish ways and means by which the faithful members of the congregations in her care grow as disciples of Jesus. Our life of faith is not static, but organic, a lifelong journey of learning what it means to be followers of Jesus in the world today. Through worship, which engages and inspires, through opportunities for praying and studying the scriptures together, perhaps in small groups of people across the churches of the ministry area, through encouragement to share the life of faith openly and honestly with one another, the people of God grow, both individually and corporately, as the body of Christ. And as we grow, we learn to listen and discern what God is asking of us. Part of building up the church is discerning gifts and skills that God has blessed his people with and encouraging them to use them. I'm often asked, why are you not appointing more clergy and younger clergy at that? Why aren't there more licensed lay ministers to help us? Well, part of the reason is that clergy and licensed lay people come from within congregations, and we've not been good or good enough at encouraging church members to ask the question, what is God asking of me? Is God calling me to serve him in some form of licensed ministry? For God calls us all to serve him in all kinds of ways, often in ways we least expect. Part of Kate's job, then, is to discern, with others, the gifting amongst the people she serves, and proactively to encourage them to use these gifts in the service of Christ. Who knows? For some, this may open up a pathway towards licensed lay ministry or ordination. All this so that the church, the people of God, can become more fully what we're called to be. Not for our own sakes, but for the sake of the world that God created and loves. Together, lay and ordained, we are to be light in the darkness of our world, shining with the brightness of the one true light. In other words, we are to be witnesses in all that we say and do to the light, the gospel, which has the power to transform lives and communities. We are to be Christ's hands and feet in the world, serving the needs of those amongst whom we live and work, speaking out against injustice and being the voice of those who have no voice. We are to be a community of faith, which is open and welcoming to all. A place where people can come to know Jesus and be drawn more deeply into his love. where those who are lost can find sanctuary and that peace of God which passes all understanding. This is not just Kate's task, nor just that of the ministry team, but the task of all in these churches, working together as unique but interdependent parts of Christ's body, outward facing, living and giving for others, drawing and pointing the people of your communities to the God who loves them more than they can begin to imagine. And in it all, growing as disciples of Jesus, discovering day by day the joys, the blessings, and the graces of living in him. May God richly bless you all as you embark on this next stage of your journey together. Amen. Kate, so far as you know your own heart, do you believe that God has called you to serve here?
I believe that God has called me.
Will you commit yourself to the mission and ministry of the people in this place to further the kingdom of God?
With the help of God, I will.
People of God, will you welcome Kate and support and uphold her in her ministry now and in the years to come? The Church in Wales is part of the one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, worshipping the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It professes the faith uniquely revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, which faith the Church is called upon to proclaim afresh in each generation. Led by the Holy Spirit, it has borne witness to Christian truth in its historic formularies, the 39 Articles of Religion, the Book of Common Prayer, and the ordering of bishops, priests, and deacons. Kate, the declaration you are about to make, will you affirm your loyalty to this inheritance of faith as your inspiration and guidance under God in bringing the grace and truth of Christ to this generation and making him known to those in your care?
I, Kate Sullivan, do solemnly declare my belief in the faith which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, and to which the historic formularies, namely the 39 Articles of Religion, the Book of Common Prayer, and the ordering of bishops, priests, and deacons, as published in 1662, bear witness, and in public prayer and administration of the sacraments, I will use only the forms of service which are allowed by lawful authority and none other. And I hereby undertake to be bound by the constitution of the Church in Wales and to accept, submit to, and carry out any sentence or judgment which may at any time be passed upon me by the Archbishop, a diocesan bishop, or any court or the tribunal of the Church in Wales. I, Kate O'Sullivan, declare that I will pay true and canonical obedience
the Lord Bishop of Monmouth and her successors, in all things lawful and honest, so help me God.
Cherry, by divine permission, Bishop of Monmouth, to our well-beloved in Christ, Kate O'Sullivan, Clerk in Holy Orders, greeting. We admit you to the Mid-Torvine Ministry Area within our diocese and jurisdiction, formed and constituted by a decree dated the 23rd day of June 2020. And belonging to our donation or collation in right of our bishopric for this term. And we do hereby duly collate and canonically institute you in and to said benefice, and invest you with all and singular the rights and authority belonging to it. You, having first in our presence made and subscribed the several declarations as provided in the Constitution of the Church in Wales, and also having made and subscribed the Declaration of Canonical Obedience to us and our successors, Bishops of Monmouth. And we do, by these presents, commit unto you the cure of souls of the parishioners of the said benefice, and authorize you to preach the word of God and to administer the holy sacraments in the same benefice, saving always to us and our successors, Bishops of Monmouth, our episcopal rights and the dignity and honor of the Cathedral Church of St. Wullace of the Diocese of Monmouth. In testimony whereof, we have caused our episcopal seal to be fixed, dated this 28th day of April, in the year of our Lord 2021, and in the second year of our consecration. Kate, receive my license as Ministry Area Leader of Mid-Torvine. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Archdeacon Sue, having admitted Kate to the cure of souls in this benefice, I ask you to induct her in the presence of this congregation. Thank you. that concludes the legal formalities. So I can now with confidence say, please welcome with me your new ministry area leader. And as I alluded to in the sermon, the work of the churches does not just belong to Kate, the ministry area leader, but the ministry area team, indeed, all of you gathered here, and all the people who are members of your respective churches. And so this renewal of commitment gives you the opportunity to commit yourselves to working alongside Kate for the good of the church, and for the furtherance of God's kingdom. And before we proceed, I'm going to invite the members of the ministry team who are gathered here with us tonight. So we've got Alison and Father Philip and Jim Thompson. I'm going to invite you to stand because you are part of the team that's going to be working with Kate across these churches. If you'd like to stand as well, Kate, to make this commitment alongside your colleagues, but this, of course, is for all of you to respond to. St. Paul, writing to the Christians in Rome, says, "As in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ. And individually, we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Prophecy in proportion to faith. Ministry in ministering. The teacher in teaching. The exhorter in exhortation. The giver in generosity. The leader in diligence. The compassionate in cheerfulness." People of God, Christ invites each of us to faithful discipleship and service. We are all called to different ministries as we seek to live God's love. As we commission Kate today, will you, with her, as baptized disciples of Christ, renew your commitment to the service of God, of one another, and of all people? Will you continue the apostles' teaching and fellowship in the bread and in prayers? Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ? Will you seek to serve Christ in all people, loving your neighbour as yourself? Will you acknowledge Christ's authority over human society by prayer for the world and its leaders, by defending the weak, and by seeking peace and justice? May Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has called us into the life of his church, equip us with the gifts of the Spirit, and enable us to live as his people. In Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, as we begin together a new way of being in Mid-Torvine, may we remember the words of Teresa of Avila. Christ has no body now but yours, no hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes through which Christ looks compassion into the world. Yours are the feet with which Christ walks to do good. Yours are the hands with which Christ blesses the world. Remind us each day that we are the body of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, As we seek to share the good news of Jesus Christ with our local community, inspire us to be creative, open, sensitive, and encouraging with each other and those we serve. Remind us that we are Christ's hands and feet, and help us to see Christ's image in all those we serve. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we serve our community in acts of loving service, inspire us to gentleness and compassion in our service of others. Inspire us with anger at the injustice and inequity we see around us, and fire up in us a desire to challenge injustice, giving voice to those who feel silenced and unheard. Lord, in your mercy, be with us as we seek to walk in your way of goodness. Help us to encourage those around us to join in the journey, even when they struggle with the concept of faith. Be alongside us as we try to live a life that glorifies you. Lord, in your mercy, as we move forward as a new ministry area, remind us that ours are hands through which Christ blesses Mid-Tor Vine. Help us to be faithful to this commission, to be people of welcome, generosity, and joy as we seek to be a beacon of hope, particularly as we venture out of COVID, offering our community a sense of hope. Lord, in your mercy, Heavenly Father, hold us and guide us as we seek to do your will for this area. Amen.
Amen.
As our Saviour taught us, we boldly pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
All-powerful Father, you have inspired Kate with the resolve to follow Christ in proclaiming his word and sacraments. Enrich her with your Holy Spirit as she guides and teaches all in her care, that she may enter more deeply into the mystery of Christ and his church. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Almighty God, who for the salvation of the world gives to his people many gifts and ministries to the advancement of his glory, stir up in you the gifts of his grace and sustain each one of you in your own ministry. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.